High quality data is reliable, accurate, and free from biases. And in DOE, there's the concept of replication, randomization, and blocking to make sure that you record high quality data. Hey, my name is Marcel. I have a PhD in chemical engineering, and this video is about the concept of replication, randomization, and blocking in experimental design. Let's first look at what exactly replication, randomization, and blocking is before we take a look at a couple of examples to see what impact it might have on your data. Replication means to repeat the same experiment multiple times. This repetition helps to quantify the natural variability in the data, and we basically make sure that the observed effects are consistent and not random. When we randomize, we conduct our experiments in a random order. This technique mitigates the impact of uncontrolled disturbance variables and reduces bias. And last but not least, blocking is used to control for the variability introduced by known but irrelevant variables. To do that, we group similar experimental units into blocks. The simplest form of blocking is to keep a certain variable constant, like for example the batch number. But not always is it that easy, and sometimes we also need to account for the block-to-block variability within our experimental design. But now let's look at a couple of examples. So Louise is an R&D manager at a tire company, and she's been given the task of testing a new rubber formula that could make a big difference in braking distances. But how does she go about proving that? The simplest way she could approach this is by just doing two tests. One with tire A, which is a competitor's tire, and one with tire B, which is the new formula. Pretty easy, right? But here's the thing. This method isn't very reliable. Why? Because things like the driver's reaction time could vary between tests. Say if the driver takes a little longer to hit the brakes during the test with tire B, it might look like the tire isn't performing as well, even if it's actually better. So Louise realizes that reaction time could be an issue, and she decides to repeat each test 10 times to get an average braking distance for each tire. Now that sounds like a much better idea, but there's another problem. The team won't be able to finish all the tests within one day, which means they have to split them over 2 days. And this could introduce a new variable, like the weather, for example. Now, if we assume that she tests tire A on day 1 and tire B on day 2, and it rains on day 2, the results for tire B might be worse just because of the wet conditions. And that wouldn't be a fair comparison, right? So to deal with the weather issue, Louise could mix up the tests. So instead of testing all of tire A on one day and all of tire B on another, she'd alternate them across both days. This would make it much more likely that both tires get tested under similar weather conditions, and it's a much better approach. But the problem is that the data can still get pretty noisy because wet and dry roads give very different results. So while it's more balanced, there's still a lot of variability. So what if we use replication, randomization, and blocking all together? In this case, she can group the tests by day, so each day is a block. She randomizes within those blocks, testing both tires each day. That way, she accounts for the day-to-day variability like weather, but still keeps things random within the day to handle any changes that happen during testing. This gives her a much more accurate comparison between the tires, even with varying conditions. Now, to sum it all up, replication helps to deal with uncertainty, like the driver's reaction time. Randomization helps to manage uncontrollable variables like weather changes during the day. And blocking is a way to control the variables we know are going to affect the outcome but are not necessarily relevant for what we would like to test. Like and subscribe for more content about DOE.